You can turn in your Bible to 1 Timothy 4. We'll be looking at verses 14 to 16. It's great to be back with you this morning. I love preaching the word. I get such joy out of it. I love studying the word. It's truly, truly a blessing. And this particular section of scripture we're in has blessed me in my study time. And when you are ready, you can stand for the reading of God's word. Okay, we're going to be reading 1 Timothy 4, verses 14 to 16. Do not neglect the gift within you, which was given to you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the council of elders. Take pains with these things, be absorbed in them, so that your progress will be evident to all. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in these things, for as you do this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Father, bless our time in your sacred word. Help us all grow in you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, I got two opening illustrations for you this morning. First, I'll tell you a rather embarrassing one. I tried sports when I was young. I wasn't at the top of the tier, okay? And I was on the track team. I think it was track, yeah. And I certainly couldn't do the sprints. Okay, that was out. I'm not fast. I've never been fast. I'm not fast. That's the way it is. I have to accept that. But I thought I would try the long distance. I think it was maybe the cross country. I don't know. I don't even remember. But anyway, I had to do this. What do they call those races? Actually, I don't even know where you run laps. Is that like the track and field, whatever. Yeah, so after run laps, man, I was so behind. I mean, I was last and I was so behind. And it was quite embarrassing. And I gave up. I called it quits. And I regret it to this day, because even finishing last, I would have finished, right? And so to this day, I regret it, because I was embarrassed. I didn't want to be last, so I thought that I would be slick and just leave the race. But that was actually more embarrassing and more pathetic. I think I told my track teacher that I just wasn't feeling well, but it was not right. It was not right. But I wish that I would have at least finished. I wish that I would have at least persevered, because even though I wouldn't have gotten a medal and even been in last place, I would have run the race. And you know, brothers and sisters, that's life. We got to do the best we can with the gifts and the abilities we have. Some of us don't have speed, but we've got to do our best. We've got to finish what we committed to. Now, in quite contrast to me, listen to this story. The secret is to run with perseverance. Here, the example of Bill Broadhurst is instructive. In 1981, Bill entered the Pepsi Challenge 10,000 meter race in Omaha, Nebraska. Now, the only thing that would excite me about that is Pepsi. Sadly. I don't really drink Pepsi, just so you know, but I did enjoy it back in the day. Surgery 10 years earlier for an aneurysm in the brain had left him paralyzed on his left side. Now on that misty July morning, he stands with 12,000 men and women at the starting line. 1,200. Well, imagine 12,000. Wow. But 1,200 is enough. The gun sounds. The crowd surges forward. Bill throws his stiff left leg forward, pivots on it as his foot hits the ground. His slow plop, plop, plop rhythm seems to mock him as the pack races into the distance. Sweat rolls down his face. Pain pierces his ankle, but he keeps going. Now, you know if that was high school Sam Torcasio, he wouldn't have kept going, sadly. But this guy keeps going. Sweat rolls down his face. Pain pierces his ankle, but he keeps going. I'm almost getting a little emotional reading this. Some of the runners complete the race in about 30 minutes. But 2 hours and 29 minutes later, Bill reaches the finish line. A man approaches from a small group of remaining bystanders. Though exhausted, Bill recognizes him from pictures in the newspaper. He is Bill Rogers, the famous marathon runner, who then drapes his newly won medal around Bill's neck. Bill Broadhurst's finish was as glorious as that of the world's greatest, though he finished last. Why? Because he ran with perseverance. That determination, unhasting and unresting, unhurrying and yet undelaying, which goes steadily on and which refuses to be deflected. Obstacles will not daunt it. Delays will not depress it. Discouragements will not take its hope away. It will halt neither for discouragement from within nor for opposition from without. It is quite within the reach of every one of us to manifest positive, conquering patience, putting one heavy foot in front of the other until we reach the glorious end. The race is not for sprinters who flame out after 100 or 200 or 400 meters. It is for faithful plodders like you and me, fast or slow, strong or weak. All must persevere. Our hearty amen. This is from Hughes, R. Kent Hughes' commentary on Hebrews. Within that is some commentary also from William Barclay. We are saved by Jesus alone, by faith alone. We are forgiven, but then we are told to run the race. We are told to live holy lives. And we're called to be righteous. But as we said, righteous biblically does not mean sinless. A righteous person biblically is someone who goes to Christ for continual forgiveness of sins and keeps plodding forward. And we want to be able to come to Christ, and we want to be able to hear him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." We know we are forgiven because of his blood. But we want to get to him saying, "Lord, I gave it my all." Now, I don't mean to be contradictory, but I believe it's evident in the nature of who we are. We will not give it our 100% all because of who we are. And that's what makes his grace so powerful. And it's that kind of tension with knowing I'll never fully measure up that keeps me wanting to do my best before a God that knows I'm weak and who has forgiven me perfectly. So I don't use his grace and I don't use his weakness as an excuse to just stop trying. But I keep going. And this is what we see here in Timothy this morning. Originally, this message was going to be two parts, but in order to not rush it, we've made it into three parts: Faithful Ministry Part 3. And we're finishing it up now by looking at the last two elements of a faithful ministry, which are using gifts for the ministry in verse 14. And perseverance until the ministry is fulfilled in verses 15 to 16. Before we do that, though, I just want to back up for a moment to verse 13, which I talked about before the baby came, so a few weeks ago now. But verse 13, I just had a couple things to finish up on that point where Paul tells him, until I come, give attention to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation and teaching. And I got mixed up with that in my notes. And there were two things I wanted to read. And one of the notes indeed was on the very page I was looking. I could not see it that morning for whatever reason. And the other note was on the very next page. So but I want to share these because I think they're important. So on the note here of verse 13 about the public reading of the Bible, exhortation and teaching, I wanted to read you a note from the early church. This is the second century church and a practice they did. But let me back up just a little bit before I get to that. And read these notes from R. Kent Hughes. He says, the public reading of Scripture was not new. It was already a part of Christian worship that had been adopted from the Jewish synagogue. The roots of this are found in the Old Testament. In Nehemiah, we had a message on Nehemiah last week. In Nehemiah, where we read of the men and women of Israel standing from early morning until midday as Ezra read the law. We see that in Nehemiah 8. This is one of the reasons many congregations stand for the reading of God's word in our worship services. Not only did Christian churches adopt the custom of the reading of the Old Testament from the synagogues, they added to it readings from the apostles' letters and the gospels, which would become the New Testament. This meant that the apostolic church put the apostles' writing on the same level as the Old Testament. Now, what did the church practice after the apostles, after the period of the apostles and the Bible being complete in the early church writings? What does that say about what a church service looked like? This is very intriguing. The early church had two public readings. One from a portion of the Old Testament, and then from the apostolic writings, which is the New Testament. Justin Martyr wrote just after the close of the first century. Listen to this. This is in the end of the first century, early second, about. This is very insightful to what church looked like in the early church. So please listen. He says, on the day called Sunday, all who live in cities or in the country gather together to one place, and the memoirs of the apostles and the writings of the prophets are read. That's the Old and New Testament that he's talking about. So the memoirs of the apostles and the writings of the prophets are read as long as time permits. Then, when the reader has finished, the president speaks, that's a reference to the pastor, instructing and exhorting the people to imitate these good things. So we see how important the public reading of Scripture was in the early church, both the Old and the New Testament. And I also want to read you another quote along that theme. From MacArthur's commentary. And he's talking about how diligent that preachers need to be to study and proclaim the word. And an old Puritan, John Flavel, he quotes saying, it is not with us preachers, which is in brackets, because in the context he's clearly talking about preachers. It is not with us preachers as with other laborers. They find their work as they leave it, so do not we. Sin and Satan unravel almost all we do. The impressions we make on our people's souls in one sermon vanish before the next. And sadly, I think there's a lot of truth to that. And that's why we have to be working so hard to make and press our point about what the Word of Christ is saying, because it often goes in one ear and out the other. And it's not necessarily because you're not listening, though I think that we all have to work on our listening skills. There could be a variety of factors, and sometimes you just know that the busyness of life, even for the most devout believer, is going to crowd out what the Word has said. So we have to work diligently to make the point to you. You have to work diligently to listen, take notes. And thankfully, we live in an age where we all have personal copies of the Bible, and we can make notes of different things the pastor said and cross-reference and write scriptures down. But it's so important because we need this to live. We need this to live. So let me go on for now and go to our first major point for this morning. Using gifts for the ministry. We see that in verse 14. Do not neglect the gift within you, which was given to you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the council of elders. MacArthur says this, not all those who enter the ministry stay the course. Some leave because they did not belong in the ministry to begin with. Others, however, defect from the place God intended them to be. Timothy was not beyond the temptation to do just that. The imperative form of the verb emaleo, do not neglect, indicates Timothy could actually be in danger of abandoning the ministry. In fact, he may have already been feeling such temptation. Now put yourself in Timothy's place. He's younger, somewhere between 30 and 40, maybe early 40s. He's got a unique position because he's kind of an outsider. He's the representative of the Apostle Paul. He's in a sense the Apostle Paul's boy. He's his guy. And the Apostle Paul sends Timothy to the Ephesian church to get things in order. So he's kind of an outsider. He's not one of the regular elders of the church. And the regular elders of the church, many of them, at least a number of them, I don't know what the ratio was between faithful to unfaithful elders, but we could say that a good number of the elders, the leaders of the Ephesian church, were going rogue. They were getting focused on stuff that was taking people's eyes off God, people's eyes off salvation, people's eyes off the lovely Lord Jesus. They were getting into, as we've seen, all these genealogies, these myths, this destructive legalism that we talked about, where they were saying you can only eat these foods and you can only you can't marry. They were forbidding marriage. And we take it, I think, reasonably that they were connecting these things to your salvation. They were getting away from grace. That's why Paul says the law is good if one uses it lawfully. They were using the law in the wrong way. They were almost certainly being Pharisaical. They were being Pharisaical. And Timothy comes into this mess. And Timothy, we infer from the scriptures, was a timid, shy guy. But he's got the encouragement from the Apostle Paul. Do not neglect the gift within you. Timothy, you've been given a gift. Don't stop using it. It wasn't that Timothy had stopped using it. It wasn't that he started neglecting it. I don't think he did. Timothy was being faithful as tired and as worn out as he may have been. But Paul was saying, don't give up. Don't give up on the gift that you have. Be not careless about it, is one way to put it. The word gift is charisma. It's from where we get charismatic. It means a gracious endowment. Charisma has grace in it. It's a gracious gift. Our gifts, we have natural abilities. Some of us have natural abilities. And we also have supernatural gifts that God gives us when we save. But our gifts, whether they're natural or they're of grace, they can be neglected, and their neglect is a sin. If we look at 2 Timothy chapter 1, just to fast forward ahead there a little bit. 2 Timothy chapter 1, Paul tells him, "For this reason I remind you to kindle afresh the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but of power and of love and of self-discipline." Verse 14, "Guard through the Holy Spirit who dwells in us the treasure which has been entrusted to you." We've been entrusted with the treasure of the gospel, and Timothy was to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit. He wasn't to do this in his own strength or his own power, but in the power of the Holy Spirit. He was given this gift through prophetic utterance. So the word of God was spoken over him, was spoken to him. He was told directly that God had called him into the ministry. And then his hands, he had had the hands of the elders laid upon him. The hands of the elders had been laid upon him. So Paul is telling him, Timothy, you got a gift inside you. A gift of preaching and teaching. Included other things as well. But mainly, I think we have a view here is gift of preaching and teaching. Timothy, you've got a gift. Timothy, the word of God was spoken to you. So number one, Timothy, you've got a gift in you. The word of God was spoken to you. And then godly men, an assembly of elders, an assembly of those that were serving God in ministry, laid their hands on you. You're not a one-man show. You didn't just decide to start your own church overnight. There's a lot of that. And we need to be careful. There are many people that are self-called. And they want to do their own. They haven't been sent out by another church. They haven't had other godly men affirm their call. And in fact, sometimes they're going against the counsel of other elders and pastors. Timothy, this wasn't you. You're not a one-man show. This wasn't your idea. You're called of God. And in other places in Scripture, as we read, Paul says, "I laid my hands on you." The Apostle Paul laid his hands. So Timothy, you have been called. Now, I think the laying on of hands didn't give Timothy the gift, but it was a symbolic gesture that he had been called. Like when we do ordinations here, the ordination is not giving the person the call when the elders come. It's from verses like this that is kind of a foundation for ordination. So you're not ordained when, you know, it's not as if the laying out of hands in and of itself transfers something to you. But men of God lay their hands on you in recognition of what God is doing in you. And that's how a lot of things in Scripture work. Communion doesn't save us. It doesn't justify us before God. But it is a symbol of our salvation. And the same with baptism. So there's a lot of things like this in Scripture where these external acts are important, but they represent something. They're not causing the thing itself. Now, where did this happen? You know, we don't know for sure. So where did Timothy get called? Where did this calling out of him happen? There's a couple possibilities. One is Acts chapter 16, verses 1 through 3. Now Paul also arrived at Derbe and at Lystra, and behold, a disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek. And he was well spoken of by the brothers who were in Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted this man to go with him, and he took him and circumcised him because of the Jews who were in those parts, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. So, it's inferred possibly that this is the place where Paul laid hands on Timothy. Now, is when Paul laid hands on him the same moment or the same time as this council of elders laid hands on him? Maybe, maybe not. But at certain points in times, we know at certain points in time, we know this. The word of God was spoken to Timothy that he was called. Paul laid hands on him. A council of elders laid hands on him. There's all this stuff in Timothy's history in which Paul is reminding him, man, again, you're not self-called. This wasn't a pipe dream of yours. God has called you into ministry. Keep going. Don't be encouraged. And again, I'll read again, 2 Timothy 1:6. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. Okay, so Paul talks about his own calling out and his setting apart of Timothy. The second point this morning, perseverance until the ministry is fulfilled. Perseverance until the ministry is fulfilled. First reading, verse 15. Take pain with these things. Be absorbed in them so that your progress will be evident to all. Homer Kent says that Paul is telling Timothy that he must continually be caring for the matters of teaching and ministry. He must continually be in the realm of these matters. He must be up to his ears in ministry. Give thyself wholly to them. Literally, go on being in them. The things of the ministry are to entirely absorb and engross him. We might say, be wrapped up in them. To take pain with these things is for Timothy to give his mind to these things. We could see that the diligence here is connected to the athletic metaphor we saw several verses earlier. In verses, let's just go to verse 8. For bodily training is only of little profit, but godliness is profitable for all things, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. So, I don't know if that's a metaphor so much as my note here says. We know that there certainly are athletic metaphors in Scripture, and in that specific part of Scripture, and we talked about the different takes on that, but one common one is that bodily exercise does exercise, physical exercise, we maybe expand that to mean physical training, does have value for life, but spiritual training and growth and godliness is so much more important. So you do kind of see that analogy there. And there certainly is an analogy here, just like the track race mentioned earlier, of persevering. Timothy, Keep being in the Word. Be obsessed with it. I think that that's the main thing in the context that Paul is talking about, because Paul has said in chapter 4, verse 13, for Timothy, we looked at it a little earlier today, to give attention to publicly reading Scripture, to exhorting, that's preaching, and teaching. To give attention to these things. Now, the conduct of his life is also important. And I think that that is also included in what he's to give attention to. He says, let no one look down on your youthfulness, but show yourself as a model to those who believe in word, conduct, love, faith, and purity. But as Paul is drawing Timothy to focus his attention on the things that Paul is telling him to do, certainly included within that, and perhaps even prime, is the ministry of preaching and teaching. The ministry is so important, as we're going to see in just a little bit, that in doing so, you'll save both yourself and those who hear you. Preaching is a matter of life and death. The pastor, the minister of God, has to be absorbed in the study of the word so that he can get it right. There are most definitely other responsibilities that the elder or pastor is called to do, to care for the flock, to visit the sick. In fact, in all of chapter 5, we're going to be talking about practical ministry, because most of chapter 5 is about ministering to widows. And we're going to see, though, that that's not just a ministry of the elders, the pastors, but the body. So we're going to be talking about ministering to widows, and we're going to expand that out. We'll probably talk a little bit about orphans and other things. And I love the ministry Lorelei has just come up with. I told her the other day, what you're doing is in line with where we are in the text, in ministering to shut-ins, and all you that are helping with that, thank you. What Jim and Cheryl and others are doing at the mission. We're going to be talking a lot about ministering to the needy, ministering to both saints and lost. Chapter 5 has a focus on ministering to needy believers, particularly widows. But we're doing great, but we got to ramp it up. Because people always say, well, Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. And I get that. And it depends on how you define religion. It depends on how you define relationship. And there's only one. There is a place, though, in Scripture that Christianity is called religion. In fact, I think it's only in one place. It's in James. And it says, true religion is this. I'm paraphrasing a little. Ministering to orphans and widows. In other words, the context is true Christianity is ministering to those in need. We got to ramp it up. And we'll be talking about that for quite a while. Pretty much all of chapter 5. A little bit more than half of chapter 5. And so that is a part of the elders' ministry and counseling and all that. But feeding the flock is primarily done when the word is preached. Martin Lloyd-Jones believed that good biblical preaching would take care of most of people's problems. Not all. And there is a time for counseling, and there is a time for one-to-one. But getting the word of God to people is essential. And the minister is to live and breathe these things. Timothy is to give all he has, all his life, to being godly, to the ministry of the word, to exercise his gift of preaching. I think I read somewhere else too about exercising the gift of discernment. Timothy certainly needed discernment with everything he was facing. But he also needed to have that life that backed up what he preached. We were just talking about that this morning in Sunday school. The power of a godly life. The power of your life. That doesn't mean you're perfect, as we've been saying many times. But when you sin, you ask for forgiveness. You repent to people, not just to our Lord, but to each other. So Paul says that your progress will be evident to all, so that people can see that from the day that you were ordained and prophesied over and called out by God, you have made progress. Friends, family, we live in a day today, you know, this is the age of the celebrity pastor. And it's not all a bad thing. I think God has called certain men to have a wide-ranging ministry. I remember, obviously, one of the men I have been most influenced by is John MacArthur, because I spent time at that seminary. And I remember him saying to us students that he's an anomaly. He doesn't know why God has blessed him so much and given him such an outreach. But there are men like him. There are others. And it's not wrong. It's not wrong to appreciate men that have an impact to thousands, even millions. But we must recognize they are but men. Because even those that are faithful, even those that are faithful men, even those that are true to the word of God, sometimes they fail us. And sometimes they fail us big. And if all our hope is on one man, we'll be disappointed. There are certainly also many charlatans and false preachers out there too. But what an encouragement. What an encouragement, as rare as it may seem, to see those that have continued faithful in ministry for years. That's an encouragement to our hearts, because it's always discouraging. And many of you can think of so many big names that we thought were faithful, but they sinned big, okay? And God knows their heart. I mean, David sinned big, right? But it still disappoints us. But our hope is not to be in men, but in Christ. Progress marks the purpose or contemplated result of his wholehearted occupation with these duties. The word progress contains the graphic picture of a pioneer cutting his way forward through obstacles by means of strenuous effort, like a man blazing a trail through a tangled forest. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Timothy, pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Acts 20:28. Turn to Acts 20:28. Acts 20:28 reads, and this is Paul, "Be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God which he purchased with his own blood. Be on guard for yourselves and all the flock." I was listening to a sermon by Albert N. Martin. Many of you may have not have heard of him. He's got some great sermons. And he was talking to seminary students, and he gave them a little quiz or something and said, "I want you to list your number one priority in ministry." And I'm thinking, well, what would I answer? And in my head. So I would just say to preach Christ. And then he said, many of you might have said that my number one goal in ministry is to preach accurate, I'm paraphrasing, biblical, expositional, exegetical sermons, which is basically a longer way of saying to faithfully preach Christ. And he says, basically, that is a wonderful thing to say, and we absolutely, that is a priority. He says, but I would have failed you if that's your answer. He says, your number one priority with ministry, and I'm paraphrasing, is to cultivate your own relationship with God through Christ. Because you're going to be no good if you don't know Christ and if you're not close to Christ. And of course, just being a minister, if you're relying on that, that is not your salvation. Your salvation is Jesus Christ. Your identity is in Him. So pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. And then he says something so interesting that in doing this, you will save. Let me just back up and read it. For as you do this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Now, Paul, how can you be telling us that Timothy can save himself and those who hear him? Don't you know salvation's by grace? You've said it. You've preached salvation through Christ in this letter. Well, remember, salvation in the Bible does not always mean eternal salvation, spiritual salvation. It does not always mean salvation from sin, death, and hell. Sometimes it can be referring to a temporary deliverance, possibly even a healing from a sickness. For example, thematically in Scripture, we know God saved the Israelites out of Egypt. He saved them out of Egypt. But that's not spiritual salvation. And even in Timothy, recall our conversation about women will be saved through childbearing. Right? I won't rehash all that now. Go back and listen. But again, we've got to look at salvation in context. And sometimes salvation is talking about when we usually think of salvation, we think justification. Justification means to be made right with God, to be forgiven of your sins. But another aspect of salvation, and there are many, but another is sanctification, and that's the process by which we become holy. Now, all that to say, I think that it makes a lot of sense here that there's two options, and I think both make sense. One is that Paul could be talking about, Timothy, you're saving yourself and the people not eternal salvation. God does that. Christ does that. But from the demonic teaching. From the false teaching that is going to hinder the church and hinder your progress in the gospel. To me, that makes a lot of sense. But Homer Kent says this in regards to another view, and I respect it. He says, some have hesitated to interpret sozes, which is salvation, in this passage in its usual Pauline sense of spiritual salvation. I guess I'm among those who hesitate, I confess. Because it is predicated of Timothy rather than of God. Such expositors refer it to a saving from difficulties or from demonic teaching. However, the basis for such a view is not sound. For Scripture clearly indicates that salvation of the soul has a present aspect in which we are commanded to, Philippians 2, 12 to 13, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God which worketh in you. So in this view, the salvation that Paul is talking about eternal salvation, and he's essentially saying, on one hand, he's saying, Timothy, get the message right. Get the message of salvation right. Make sure that you are not drifting away from the message of salvation. And this would be tied to justification, but not that Timothy saves, but that Timothy is accurately telling people how to be saved through God and through Christ. These false teachers were so drifting away from the message that their salvation was in question. They were drifting away, I believe, from the message of Christ. This was serious. I don't know all their hearts, but this was serious. And when you start drifting away from the message of Christ and you start going to other things, you're in danger of showing you don't really believe the gospel. And if a minister is not careful to make sure that he is believing in Christ, what's he going to give the people? So in the sense of Timothy, make sure you're getting salvation right. Make sure you're getting the message right so that the people understand it. And we know, look at churches across America. Look at how they've gone astray. It's not hard to believe. Look at all the mainline denominations. All the mainline denominations, they have some faithful within them, but by and large, they've gone. Look at our non-denominational churches are not perfect. You know, I pick on mega churches a lot. Not all mega churches are bad. Please understand me. But they really are getting control. I couldn't believe what I heard the other day. I almost showed you a video, but it's like, why show you the video and fill your mind with that? But I'm going to tell you. You know what this big mega church did on... I'm upset about this. You know what they did on Super Bowl Sunday, Claudia? They kicked a Bible. Are you crazy? Are you insane? You think that's funny? What's the matter with you? A supposed woman pastor, oh, this is cool. It's Super Bowl Sunday. I'm going to kick a field goal with the Bible. Well, I'm sorry, what's going on? How in the world do we think that is church? Am I insane? Maybe, but they are too. We gotta stick to the word of God. Like I said, I'm not again with having fun and stuff like that. But come on, people are carrying it too far. Are you serious? That's just so disrespectful. It makes me mad. It does. Kicking a Bible. But anyway, but you could see how people get off track. And again, there's also that aspect. I'll just wrap up this thought with this. In, you know, when we're working out our salvation, just more broadly, generally speaking, it's not talking about justification, but it's talking about our sanctification. And look, I wanted to end with this. I just wanted to end with the gospel. And gentlemen, you can bring the screen down. Oh, it's already down. I wanted to end with the gospel. Because this is where Paul is ending, and he's talking about, you know... Whatever his particular emphasis here, we know Paul is deeply concerned about people knowing Jesus, about people knowing Christ. And listen, the gospel is Christ. The gospel is that Jesus died for your sins. The gospel is that Jesus bore the wrath of God. The gospel's him. There's nothing to add to it. The gospel is Christ. The gospel is that God has shown us his love in Jesus. That Jesus has died for the sins of the world. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Our response to the gospel is repenting of sin and believing in Jesus. They go together. But the gospel, the substance of the gospel, the cure, our hope, is what Jesus did on the cross. Our response to it is just drinking the cup. Our response isn't the gospel. The gospel is the cup of salvation in Jesus that we drink. And that's what I believe what Jesus is talking about when he says, you've got to eat my flesh and drink my blood, metaphorically, for believing in him. Well, what does it mean to believe in him? Well, just a couple things to encourage you. Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11. Verses 28-30. This is what believing in Jesus looks like. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. John 6:37. And you can just listen as I go there quickly. John 6:37. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will never cast out. If you've come to Jesus in faith, he's got you. He's got you. Back up to, or just listen, John 5:24. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come into judgment, but has passed out of death into life. My brother, my sister, if you've come to Jesus this morning, I want to assure you, your sins are forgiven. No matter what hard time you're going through, what personal problems, people problems you have in your life, if you can wake up and say, Jesus has forgiven me, he's died for my sins, what a peace, what a joy. And so God, the moment we believe with that repentant belief, he forgives us forever. He clothes us with his own righteousness. He not only forgives us, but we can actually talk to him. We can commune with, we can approach the holy God because of the blood of Jesus. But then he leaves us here, let me finish the sentence, with a sin nature. But he doesn't abandon us even here. Because Hebrews 4 tells us we have a high priest who is able to sympathize with our weaknesses. Therefore, we can draw near to the throne of grace. Yes, he leaves us with a sin nature because he wants us to grow. He wants us to learn. It's not an automatic zap. He wants us to keep coming to him. The gospel is not just for unbelievers. It's for believers. We need Jesus every day. And then he tells us, he communicates to us through his word that we are to run the right race and we are to live a holy life knowing we are forgiven. And scripture-wise, I'll conclude with Hebrews 12:1. Actually, I'll read 1 and 2. You know, I have a question for you. How come when I practice these sermons, they're a half hour, but when I get up here, they're always longer? It's all right. It's all right. I just have a little fun with it. Because sometimes I'm like, man, am I going to have enough to say? But then I get up here and it's like, yeah, you got enough to say. But Hebrews 12:1. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, laying aside every weight and the sin which so easily entangles us, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Excuse me, it says the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Brothers and sisters, when it tells us to run that race and to not give up like me in track, when it tells us to keep going, no matter how pathetic a job we do, we need to do our best for Jesus. And sometimes the people, it looks like they didn't do much, Jesus is going to be happy with them because they gave him their best. And it says to lay aside every sin, simple. If the Bible calls it a sin, cut it out of your life. Now, you've got to read the Bible to understand what the Bible says, and that takes time, and that takes growth. I remember one lady telling me when she first got saved, she didn't want to read the Bible because she kept learning what was a sin. Eventually, she was okay, because the Holy Spirit helps us. Our Lord is with us. He's gracious, and he gives us the power to overcome. But listen to this. It's not just sin that we put aside, but every weight. My brother, my sister, that means that even if it's not a sin, if it is a weight in your life that's keeping you from closeness to Jesus, let it go. Well, how do I know? How do I know if it's, well, it may be one of those gray areas where you've got to pray, you've got to study the Bible, get counsel, talk to a lot of people. And if the overall consensus is, brother, sister, this is weighing down your life, even if it's not a sin, let it go and run the race. You don't need it. You need Jesus. Now, he's faithful to us, even when we go through hard times, when it doesn't look right. One of my favorite contemporary Christian singers is Toby Mac. Please be encouraged by this song. And then we'll close in prayer.
It's been a long year, it almost took me down, I swear. Life was so good, I'm not so sure we knew what we had. I'll never be the same man, I'll never feel like I felt before. It's been a hard year, it almost took me down. But when my world broke into pieces, you were there faithfully. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you made a way for me. I may never be the same man, but I'm a man who still believes. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you were there faithfully. I've had a hard time finding the blue in the skies above me. If I'm keeping it real, I've been half faking the happy they see. I may look like the same man, but I'm half the man I was. It's been a hard year, it almost took me down. But when my world broke into pieces, you were there faithfully. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you made a way for me. I may never be the same man, but I'm a man who still believes. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you were there faithfully. In my darkest hour, you met me so quietly, so gently. You said you'd never leave, and you stood by your word. So quietly, so gently, in all my pain, you met me. You said you'd never leave, stood by your word. 'Cause when my world broke into pieces, you were there faithfully. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you made a way for me. I may never be the same man, but I'm a man who still believes. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you were there faithfully. When I cried out to you, Jesus, you were there faithfully.
Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity to proclaim your word this morning and to be with the people of God and to worship you. I pray that our offering of worship is acceptable. Thank you for walking with us. Thank you for being faithful to us, even when I'm not faithful to you. And Lord, still in my life, show me, Lord, gently lead me in the things that need to be more conformed to you, that the things that need to change. And I pray that for all of us. Help us to be sanctified and to run this race. But thank you for not giving up on us. Thank you for holding us. Thank you for causing us to be born again. And if there be any here that have not truly believed in Christ, Father, I pray that they do right now. So I thank you for this morning. The ministry is not over. I pray it continues throughout the day. Be merciful to us all. Protect us. Keep us safe from the enemy. In Jesus, our Lord's, our God's name. Amen. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you in a bit. I will try to make my way to the foyer and say hello. It's good to be back.